We're very fortunate tonight to have a very talented speaker, and you all know who he is, so I won't introduce him other than telling you it's Donald Pettit.
Thanks, George. So everybody, just keep chowing down, get your food, and I'll just start talking, and I think that'll make it the best here. I really like the concept of a frontier. You can't hear me? Okay, testing 1, 2, 3, that's all on. Okay, let's see. So, I really like the concept of a frontier. And a frontier is a place, can you hear me now without that? Tested? Okay. A frontier is a place where your normal intuition doesn't necessarily apply. It's a place. You can't hear me? Okay.
He'll bring it back out, and that way the recording can hear what you're saying.
Okay, but you guys can't hear me. Okay. Okay, I'll stay here. Okay, a frontier is a place where a normal intuition doesn't necessarily apply. You observe things that are different from life back home. Oh, we're getting a microphone change out.
Yeah.
Okay, can you hear that? Oh, good. Now I can walk around. Okay, so things in a frontier operate differently than life back home. The answers are not in the back of the book, and you may find yourself having to figure things out for yourself. And I think that's one of the delightful reasons that sends human beings into frontiers, is that it's not like home. You get to learn new things. It tickles your imagination. It enriches your mind. And I like to use this picture here, taken in the cupola module on station. I like to use this as one example of a detail that you see in a frontier. So this window is looking out, we're somewhere over China, looking out past the Himalayas into India. And if you know where to look, Mount Everest is in that picture. But dozens of astronauts have taken tens of thousands of pictures through this window. And you could have the mindset that, why bother to take another picture because it's already been done? But if you remember, you're in a frontier, and the way you make an observation can change what you see. So you take your camera and you change the exposures on your camera, and now you can see this. It's the same window, it's the same planet, but you're seeing new information. And now you change the settings again and you can see this. So you're in a frontier. The data you collect depends on how you make the observation. And just because somebody else has already been there and done that doesn't mean that you can't go there and make a completely new observation. You can collect new data. So the very concept of been there, done that does not apply on a frontier. Now, this gets me to the title of my talk. I like to call it Science of Opportunity. And these are a series of vignettes from little investigations I did on station, primarily for educational demonstrations. And these are things that you do outside of the programmatic work in your spare time, or I should say off-duty time on station. And I like to call it science of opportunity. It's the same way that we use our laboratories down here on Earth, where you have a programmatic research project that funds and pays for what you do, but because you're in the lab and you got a brain, you think of other things and you just use the facilities to make new observations and little experiments. And we could do this on space station. But instead of calling this science of opportunity, I thought maybe another title would be Techno Stories from Space. Because these are really stories. They're little vignettes of these educational things that I did. But then a lot of these projects turned out to have some scientific meaning to them. And so I thought, well, let me really call my talk Scientific Advances from What Appears to Be Goofing Around in Space. And remember, this is on the space station, so your tax dollars are paying for all of it. So here I am. I'm working with yo-yos. This is the paragon example of goofing around, right? You're doing yo-yo stuff. But the physics behind a yo-yo, it's basic physics, but it operates in a little different way. There I'm doing a new trick, never possible on Earth. I call it the tether assist. And then I'm doing lunar loops, another tether assist. Look at that. You can do things with something as simple as a yo-yo. The physics you understand, but the gravitational forces have been removed, and it allows you to do new things. And it's one of the main examples of what you would think would be goofing around. Now, here's a little investigation I started with just little bits of wire on station. Add some soap from my shaving kit. And what I wanted to do was to make a wire loop and then draw out some soap films. And for no reason other than I thought about drawing some water films out. Let me try it without any soap. What happens? Because you can't draw a soap film without soap down here. And so I would pull these wire, I'd put the wire loop in water, and I'd pull it out, and this was the equivalent of distilled water, and you could make a water film. And it's like, wow, let's see what we can do with playing with these water films. And here's a couple of them up there. And I'm using one of my cleanest dirty shirts for a photography background. And let's see what you can do with these films. And here's a video showing how you can make them. And that's just the deionized water that we have on station. And you can draw a film of this highly purified water. It's got about 240 part per billion total organic carbon in it, so it's pretty good stuff. And you can make these films typically around 200 microns thick, but I've made them as thin as 50 microns. So these are now little fluid containers that are truly two-dimensional. And you can look at fluid flow problems now in a two-dimensional nature. And so what can you use these for? Well, one of the things that I did was I used them as an aqueous crystallizing system, where I took our galley salt, which is a near saturated solution of sodium chloride, and I made films with the sodium chloride, and then I let it evaporate. I would add more salt to it as the evaporation would occur, and you can grow sodium chloride crystals. And they grow in a two-dimensional wafer. These crystals are about 200 microns thick, so you can grow these crystals, and you get different shapes depending on where the seed crystal happened to get oriented before you started to get this wafer kind of growth. And here's a time lapse that shows the growth of these crystals over a period of a couple of days. And you can grow crystals that are upwards of 20 millimeters on an edge. And this is just sodium chloride. This is just goofing around. And what I ended up doing was I ran across a colleague in Switzerland who works in the salt industry. He literally works in a salt mine, and he does research on sodium chloride. And we got together and he took some of my data and we analyzed the crystals and we got a peer-reviewed scientific paper out of this in the Journal of Crystal Growth. And then on my next flight, we continued the investigation and we got a second publication in the Journal of Crystal Growth. So we're just goofing around and we got some real science out of this. Now, here's another example of using, this is water with some tracer particles in it. And I took the soldering iron, which I don't think we would have had a soldering iron on station if it wasn't for Shep. And you heat the side of the wire where the water is touching it, and you incite convection. And this is commonly called Marangoni convection, but really, if you get into hardcore scientists talking about this, it's thermocapillary flow. And you can see this. And I ran across a fellow from JAXA who does thermocapillary flow, and we ended up using these simple videos. We got this paper published in the European Conference for Microfluidics. And then a couple years later, Yeno-san and I were talking, and he said that in my first set of experiments, we had a convex surface on the water film, and that the fluid motion was to the hot wall. And he said that he had some really sharp graduate students that did some modeling, and if I could make a fluid film that had a concave surface, he said the flow should reverse direction. And I thought, wow, that's kind of neat. So I was getting ready to fly, and I tried that experiment. So here's the experiment. There's Shep soldering iron, and it's a convex surface or concave surface. And look at that. The flow goes away from the heat source. So Yeno-san and his students were exactly correct in terms of modeling this system. And as a result of this, we got another paper. This was published in Microgravity Science. So we got another paper on the thermocapillary flow. And we're just goofing around. Now, here are some Legos. And we had a whole series of NASA Education Office Lego demonstrations that we did. And after the experiments were done, I did like any self-respecting kid would do. And you take the Legos apart and you build whatever you want to from the Legos. You throw the instruction booklet away. And what I have here, I've got a little frame. It was some pulleys and a big rubber band and a little bits of copper wire. And I could drive one pulley with our drill driver. And this makes a Belt and Rollers Van de Graaff generator. But I didn't have a sphere. So what I did, I had some aluminum foil. So I figured, well, maybe if I make the collector as a cylinder, it won't be ideal, but it'll be good enough. So I made a cylinder and used that for a cylinder for a while, and then I finally found a sphere and I switched over to the sphere. So let's watch this video and it'll show the making of this Van de Graaff generator. This is the basis for a Van de Graaff generator. This isn't ideal, but it'll probably work. And now, this isn't little kid stuff anymore. And this is when I got the sphere. We could shoot an 80 millimeter long spark, which at atmospheric pressure is about 100,000 static electric volts. And so what do you do once you have this? You realize that charge forces are weak compared to gravity. So you're in this environment where now you can investigate charge forces without having gravitational forces interact with it. And so here's an example of what I did. I was squirting water at this sphere. And you basically make little planets going in orbit around the sphere. Look at that. Isn't that cool? And so I shot all kinds of video doing that, and then I started to put fluids on the sphere. And every kind of fluid I could find, I would put on the sphere. And you're looking at the interaction, the balance between surface tension force and charge force without gravitational force interfering. And I could make these fluid cones upwards of 5 centimeters. And it turns out there's a whole field of study dealing with charged liquid cones. These are called Taylor cones. And a guy by the name of G.I. Taylor did this work back in the 1920s. And this is really important in inkjet printers and spray charge painting. And it's used industrially a lot. And there's research going on with these Taylor cone systems. And I happened to run across a fellow by the name of Boris Herzed, and he's at the New Jersey Institute of Technology, and he does research on these Taylor cones. And we ended up with a collaborative project where we analyzed these Taylor cones on my video, and here's what we turned out. Here's a plot, and it's a plot of log of a characteristic height, a scaled height of the Taylor cone versus log of time, and we're looking at how they oscillate. And the best he could do down here in his lab with all his graduate students was a 0.5 millimeter characteristic length on these Taylor cones, and we had data now that went up to 5 centimeters. So we expanded his data set by 2 orders of magnitude. And when we plot it up like this, the slope line connecting the data, you get one nice slope line. And it turns out that's the experimental slope. Turns out the theory governing this has a predicted slope around 0.63. So we're the theory and the experiment do really well in terms of modeling themselves. And so we ended up with a paper. This was in Phys Review Letters. This is a high quality, peer reviewed professional journal. And we got, you know, the scientists always write these boring titles. I mean, detection of a dynamic cone shaped meniscus on the surface of fluids in electrical fields. I mean, what a boring title. But anyway, we got this paper published in 2015. And the neat thing about this paper, here's an excerpt from the experimental section. I love this. Van de Graaff generator assembled from Legos. So I have it here in this peer-reviewed physics paper. I've got the experimental apparatus documented, Legos, on space station. And we were just goofing around. Oh. Tintin explores the moon. How many people here grew up or at least have read this book? Okay, Shap, I bet you've done it. Okay, now, this was written in 1953. So that kind of dates everybody that's looked at this. But it's also before we'd ever launched a rocket into space, before human beings had ever traveled into space. And the author was pretty clairvoyant here. And look at this, moon rocket to Earth. This is Professor Calculus. The author realized that math was going to be important if you wanted to make rockets and go into space. And I point this out to students, because when I talk to students, I like to see a show of hands. How many out there in the students want to do my job? And not all, but most raise their hand. And then I go, you see, you got to know your math. You got to be Professor Calculus or you're not going to get your rocket built. This guy decided that the astronauts would really be sailors. And so he had this character, Haddock, who was his salty sailor type. And remember, this was before the fighter pilot model was used for astronauts. And so I had a thought, well, I'm going to the moon, maybe I ought to learn something about astronomy. So he decided to bring his astronomy book with him on the mission. And there it is. And this is the kind of book that we need on space station, you know. And so his book was really a way to smuggle whiskey on board. And there he is. He's trying to drink his whiskey, and it either stays in the glass and you can't drink it, or it floats out like that into a little sphere. And I thought this was amazing that before anybody had even traveled into space and really thought about these problems, the guy that wrote this strip knew that a regular glass is not going to work in a weightless environment. And then he even knew that you're going to end up making a mess like this. So the NASA engineers, they're really clever people, and they knew that this was going to happen, and so they came up with the juice bag. Basically, it's a pouch. We can put coffee in it, freeze-dried coffee. You add hot water, and you suck all your fluids through a straw. But a bottle or a glass like this simply will not work. Well, on one of my missions, I got this idea. I remembered some of my fluid physics from chemistry. I wasn't just sleeping in class. I remembered wetting angles and surface tension and this stuff. And I took some scrap materials on station. This is some sheet plastic and capped on tape. And I made an open container with this shape. And I got the plastic. We had this book on station. It was titled Emergency Procedures Volume 1. And, you know, it only dealt with depressed fire and toxic release of ammonia. But in the back of the book, there were a few plastic sheets. And I figured nobody will miss a few plastic sheets, right? And so I was able to take those sheets out, and I taped them up with our Kapton tape, and I made this particular geometry, because this geometry is essential for making an open container that you can use in a weightless environment in a manner that's almost indistinguishable from using an open container down here. And the trick is that acute angle that runs up the wall. So let's look at the video. So here I have this, and I'm squirting some tea in there. And look, you get capillary-driven channel flow, goes up the side, and it parks the fluid right next to the lip. And so now you can drink your fluids. That angle has to be less than 2 times the quantity, 90 minus a wetting angle, and then you'll get the capillary flow. So there's Steve Bowen and I doing a toast, and you can, orientation makes no difference. And then you can drink these things to dryness. Look at that. So these things work really well. So now for the first time, here we are as crew of Expedition 6. And you know, imagine maybe you completed an EVA, or maybe you've flown the robotic arm and snagged the first commercial spacecraft coming up, and you want to have a celebration with your crew members in a manner that's commensurate with how human beings live and work on Earth. And this is not an uncommon occurrence. When human beings go into a frontier, they take elements from civilization with them, and even though they are malaligned with that environment, they'll figure out some way to make it work. And an example is, you're in Antarctica, it's Antarctic summer, you're camped in a tent with 8 other people, and somehow you figure out how to get a Christmas tree down there. You know, human beings are really good at improvising like that. And so now we have this cup, and we can toast and drink and take our beverages in a manner commensurate with how people on Earth do. Now, this is the second generation. And the shape of this is chosen purely from mathematics of fluid physics applied in microgravity for an open container. There's no art involved in this. And this second generation cup was instigated by a good colleague of mine at Portland State University, Mark Weislogel, and he had a whole cadre of graduate students, and they worked on this design, and we flew six of these up to space station. And they worked so well, we were able to write a proposal to this place called CASIS. Has anybody here ever heard of CASIS? And I was hoping Box would have stayed around because I wanted him to hear that. Anyway, so we got an official experiment on station, the Capillary Beverage Cup for demonstration on ISS. And so now this was an official NASA project. And remember, we're just goofing around. It's coffee. And so here's Chell Lindgren setting up the experiment. And if you're careful, you can set up your video camera with good backgrounds, with length scales, where your views are parallel or perpendicular to the phenomenon that you want, and you can get pretty good data from that. And here's another example. So if you intentionally have bubbles in there, now you can mark and track the fluid flow. And so what you can do from these videos, you can go back to Portland State University, where Mark has a couple graduate students chained to a desk computer. And you can have them analyze this frame by frame, and they can look at the particle motion. And then maybe once or twice a day, you throw a few hamburgers into the room. And now, you can get this kind of information. We have position frame by frame, and now you can get velocity, and then you take the first derivative and you get acceleration, and then you do a Fourier transform, and now you've got the frequency. So now, just from coffee and goofing around, you can get real scientific data, and then you can publish more papers. Now, we were goofing around with this, and happened to be a JAXA astronaut, Kimya, was on station running the experiment at the time, and between working directly with the PIs on the ground, and I think this is important, we're doing this now with station, crew members, instead of talking through a Capcom, where the story gets warped a little bit, can now talk directly with the PIs on the ground, the principal investigators, and that way, you can get a new spark of innovation in terms of running and operating your experiment. And so here's something that Kimya set up for us while we were talking to him. This is a zero gravity siphon. And we know siphons, like pendulums, are gravity machines. They only work when there's gravity. But here we devised a system previously unthought of, where we could use capillary forces to drive a siphon. And basically, the radius of curvature next to the hose on one side is different than the radius of curvature in the free fluid on the other side. And you get a pressure gradient because the radius of curvatures are different, and that drives the siphon. And as soon as the flow goes to the point where the two radius of curvatures are equal, that's like the liquid level in a standard gravity siphon, the liquid levels being equal. And nobody had ever thought about this. And this came up because of a discourse or a conversation directly between the PI and the folks who were lucky enough to be on orbit. So, what else can you do with this cup? Well, there's Chell Lindgren. You can drink coffee. And one of the things that this allows you to do, if you drink your coffee from a bag, you can't smell it. And now we're drinking it from an open container, and you can smell your coffee, and that adds, that's probably 80% of the effect of drinking coffee. And then, Samantha Cristoforetti flew. Italian ESA astronaut. And you know these Italians, they really like their coffee. And she was able to convince people to fly an espresso machine. And think about it. Espresso machine has a boiler, 9 atmospheres pressure, superheated water, gets injected through an ampule of coffee, and they were able to get all of that through NASA safety, and it flew on station. And Samantha was the first person to enjoy real brewed coffee, and not only brewed coffee, but espresso coffee. And she downlinked this picture, and I was thinking, wow, you know, a room with a view, drinking coffee from a cup, open container, you can smell it, and it's espresso. And I started looking at this closer and closer, and something didn't seem quite right. And so here's an enlargement. Look at that. That's an enlargement from that same picture with a little bit of image processing. The crema, which is all the little bubbles that float on the surface of espresso, and they have a bubble size distribution from around 500 microns going down to maybe 25 microns. And there's actually a paper published by an Italian scientist that talks about the physics of crema. And the bubbles turn out to be carbon dioxide, by the way, which was really surprising to me. And I looked at that. Look at that. The crema's distributed throughout the volume, which is not unexpected because you don't have gravitational buoyancy separating it, but it's forming a spontaneous structure. What's going on there? You got the bigger bubbles surrounded by orbiting little bubbles. It's like you're creating solar systems inside of your cup of espresso, and these solar systems are arranging into galaxies. So you're creating a whole universe inside of your simple cup of espresso. And there's an example of espresso in the same cup, made with the same machine, because we got to have controls, right? We're scientists. And you can see you've got the crema, and there's a bubble size distribution and all of that. There's even a little bit of capillary rise going up the acute angle. But there's no spontaneous structure that forms throughout the volume of the espresso. And so I've been talking with Mark Weitzlog about this, and I only noticed this in this picture maybe 6 months ago. And we've had this data for maybe 2.5 years. So we're scratching our heads. We still don't have an answer as to why it spontaneously forms this structure. And maybe the physics will do nothing more than tickle our imagination, but maybe there'll be something behind this physics that'll help us make passive systems that can deal with two-phase flow, particularly for life support. Who knows? So here's the state of the zero-gravity cup right now. There's the original one conceived and built on station out of stuff. Maybe I ought to return that sheet back to the emergency procedures. And then there's the second generation where the shape was the mathematics of fluid physics designed by Mark Weisselog and his graduate students. And now I'm working on the third generation, which I'm slip casting these in my garage out of porcelain. And I'm making it really, really thin because I like Bleak. It's this Irish porcelain that's eggshell thin, and I'm trying to make it under the style of Bleak, but the Bleak factory's been in business for maybe 230 years, and I've been doing this for about 3, so I still have a little learning to do. But anyway, we're working on the third generation, and we've gotten approval from NASA safety to fly them up to station if we slather them with Kapton tape. But they're in the process of going. So we got a patent on this. And this is the first patent granted for something invented on space station. In fact, it's the first patent granted for something invented in space. Everything else has been invented on Earth, built on Earth, and flown into space. But this was thought of and designed and built on space station. And it took a while for NASA Legal to figure out, you know, what can you do with this? And they were, NASA Legal has actually written a paper on intellectual property invented on space station. And they're using a maritime a procedure on this, and this is documented. If a ship is traveling from one place to another and you're in international water and you have an invention made that has intellectual property value, the patent rights and procedures have to go to the company of the ship registry, the country of the ship registry. So I was thinking, well, if you apply this to station, then if you're in the JAXA module and you make an invention, then it has to go through the Japanese process of patents. If you're 15 feet over in the Columbus module, then you go through European patent stuff. And then, fortunately, I built the first zero-G cup in the U.S. lab and Node 2, so I could go through U.S. patent. And now we have a second patent applied for, and it hasn't been granted yet, but we're working on it, working it through the patent system. This is for the second generation design. And then we got a paper. And this is in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics. And there, you know, my ugly mug right there in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics, peer-reviewed paper. And again, I love the title of these things. Look at this. Quasi-steady capillary-driven flow in slender containers with interior edges. I mean, nobody ever knew what that was about. And then we have our preliminary results from the capillary beverage experiment, and we presented them at a fluid dynamics conference, and it's drinking in space. Not what you think, drinking in space, a capillary beverage experiment, and Mark Weisslagel and I, we're working on the actual article that will go through peer review and probably submit it to the Journal of Fluid Mechanics. And then there was an art show at Space Center Houston. And this was, the driving force behind it was Nicole Stott and Jancy McPhee Love, who was here on the education panel, and she's had to leave early. And so we had this art show with all different kinds of space art, and I was one of many exhibitors there. And we had the original and the plastic ones and the slipcast porcelain ones there. Because of this, there's this museum in London called the Beazley Museum of Design, and they wanted us to submit one of these to go on display there. So we did that. And so the Beazley Design Museum, and this is in London, and we didn't realize, but every year their directors and patrons vote on the different designs that are displayed, and we got the Beazley Design of the Year for 2016. So, I mean, this is just coffee, right? I mean, we're just goofing around in space. And it turns out Samantha Cristoforetti has a good friend at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. And she was talking to the director about the Space Cup, and then the director contacted me and asked if I would donate a set of these cups. So I was able, again, working through NASA Legal, to donate a set of these cups to MoMA, and they're in the archives. They're not on display yet, but maybe they will be. Okay, this is kind of a segue slide. I'm going to switch to observations and the resulting science that you could do by just looking out the windows. And that's the cupola on space station. This was a self-portrait taken from the Russian segment from the SO module, which looks in the US segment, and you could set a camera up and time lapse or time a delay, and you could quickly fly over probably about 75 meters and pop up in the cupola just in time for a picture. And let me run a short video here. I call it Photo Frenzy.
I'm Don Pettit. We're on the International Space Station in the cupola module. It's our window to planet Earth. Here we are
7 windows and 8 cameras. It doesn't get any better than this.
You don't mess around. You take
No. And I'm mapping. And I've shot faster than my card can take. So I switched to another camera.
You want this card in this other D3 here?
Yeah, go ahead. Oh, there's Great Salt Lake. Look at that.
It is salty.
Oh, look at the fire. Look at that, man. The place is burning up. That storm is awesome. Look at this, man.
Oh, that's...
Yeah, right. Is that with a fisheye?
That's the fisheye?
That's a fisheye. See, I am just a wide-angle person, man.
Yeah, I'm with you.
You know...
You're that far away, you don't get the windows in there, are you?
Oh, I am getting the windows. See, that's half the effect with the fisheye is you get the windows. See, look at that.
Oh, yeah.
See, look at that picture. Yeah. See, so you get the whole Mother Earth effect.
Dude, I'm going to be all about the fisheye.
Oh, man, that is so
good. That's money right there.
Yeah, that is money. This is going to be cover of National Geographic. You know, that'd mean more to me than getting astronaut Hall of Fame. You know, who cares about that astronaut stuff?
So that's what it's like doing a photo session in the cupola, sort of a photo frenzy. And I want to cover a little topic here. I call them cities at night. And this is a picture of Montreal, and it's about the best you could do with a handheld camera. And the exposures would be of the order of 3/4 of a second to 1 second, and there's always going to be jiggle and orbital motion. And I wasn't happy with that, because the cities from space look just so beautiful, and I wanted to figure out how to capture it. So I put this together from junk. I found the old IMAX movie camera mount sitting in a closet, and I took our drill driver, and there's a little threaded bolt that the drill driver can drive, and it pushes on a platform, and it moves one dimension, a gimbal, at a rate that you can match to orbital rate. And I got that bolt. I got it from a Russian Progress vehicle. And, you know, I figured that vehicle burns up in the atmosphere, and they're not going to miss one little bolt. And then there's two cameras on there. There's one camera with a long telephoto lens that's just used as a spotting scope. So you look through that camera, adjust the speed of the drill driver that matches the rate of the gimbal so that the city lights are stationary, and then you use a cable release and you take a picture with the other camera. And so here's how you might use it. You could get about 3 pictures before you had to stop, back up your threaded bolt. So with this equipment, you could compensate for orbital motion. You could take these longish exposures of cities, maybe 1/2 second, 3/4 of a second, 1 second, and you could reduce the blur from the orbital motion. So again, that's Montreal, the best we could do with handheld photography. And there's Montreal with this barn door tracker. And amateur astronomers are familiar with things like this, because we'll make an apparatus like that on Earth to track Earth motion, so you can take a time exposure of the heavens. And here I was on station using the same technology to counteract orbital motion to take pictures of Earth. And so once I got this set up, systematically, we took pictures of all around Earth. There's Chicago, and that's Las Vegas. And it truly is really, really bright down there. You can see the strip. And I like to say that Las Vegas is the beacon of humanity. And here's a mosaic assembled from these. It goes all the way from Los Angeles all the way down to San Diego and just to the tip of North Island down there. And that was circa 2002, 2003 on Expedition 6. And the barn door tracker was used on a number of expeditions past that, but then the cameras, the camera technology improved, and it got to the point where you didn't need that barn door tracker anymore, that the camera speeds are fast enough that you could take pictures of cities at night now at 125th of a second. And so you can just do hand compensation for orbital motion and get just as good a pictures, sometimes better. So that barn door tracker was returned to Earth on a Progress vehicle some time ago. But the result of this, I got another paper. This was in the International Journal of Remote Sensing, and this was from colleagues at NOAA in Boulder, and they saw these pictures coming down from station. They started to analyze Thades on them, and they needed some of my help in terms of how they were made. And so they ended up putting me on as a co-author. And then we got another paper out of it too. This is in the Geo Journal, and these are peer-reviewed journals. And then these guys were prolific. They kept cranking out these papers. I think they're trying to get tenure or something. But anyway, we got a bunch of publications from that basically were derived from this barn door tracker, which was made from parts and junk on station. Let's see. I've got one more little topic here. Would you mind if I keep talking, or should we? Is the bar closed now, or does anyone need to make a bar run? Okay. Well, this has to do again with an amateur astronomy topic. It's star trail pictures, I took this on the roof of my house in Los Alamos, New Mexico. This was circa 1994, and you take a camera, put it on a tripod, point it towards the North Star, make a nice time exposure, and Earth rotates and everything goes around the North Star. And there happened to be a comet there, which was discovered by an amateur astronomer from Japan. So it has a name on it, which I can't pronounce, but it is named after a Japanese amateur astronomer. Yeah, okay, Kaz, I knew you would know that. Thanks. And it was neat because this comet happened to go right by Polaris, so you could get a picture like this. So having this kind of a background, I wanted to do this on space station. So here's one of my results for a star trail picture on space station. And there's a lot of physics, Earth physics, in this. First off, you see the stars are all rotating around a point, and you think, Polaris, right? Because all the pictures down here are rotating around Polaris. But minus 10 points if you're thinking that. That's the pitch axis of station, which is inclined 51.6 degrees to the equator. So that point is the complement angle. So it's 90 minus 51.6 degrees projected out into space. Stars are going in circles. That kind of green thing that's laying on top of Earth, that's our atmosphere. And the scale height of that's about 100 kilometers. And the top of that is entry interface. That's where spacecraft start to get really hot. That's where you're glad you have a heat shield that engineers that know how to do math figured out how to make the heat shield, because that's where things start to get hot. And it glows green from a phenomenon scientists call air glow. Go figure. And it glows green because it's a 557 nanometer line from atomic oxygen. And notice the stars, as they go through at an angle in the atmosphere, as they get closer to Earth, the radius of curvature changes. And that's because the density of the atmosphere changes with altitude, and the refractive index changes with density. So the atmosphere is acting like a lens. And so the stars, as they move through the atmosphere, and before they get eclipsed by the limb of the Earth, the slope gradient changes. And then cities, that's what those orange streaks are, cities on Earth, sodium vapor lights, and what those white things, that's a thunderstorm. So here's another example. You get a thunderstorm, and it goes flash, and then there's orbital motion, and then it goes flash again, and then flash again. And so that's a time history of a single thunderstorm. And you can see that there's structural detail that has changed but recognizable between these flashes. And the science that you can distill out of these just goes on and on and on. See that real faint region way above, above the atmosphere? That's the F region of the atmosphere. It's centered about 400 kilometers. And it's red from atomic oxygen, but it's excited and glowing at 640 nanometers. And the center of that red zone, that's our orbital altitude on station. We're at 400 kilometers. So we go over the green, but through the red. Really neat stuff, really neat stuff. And then there are other things dealing here. Now, this is a picture. It's over Southeast Asia. And instead of seeing the standard blue-green light from mercury vapor or the yellow light from sodium vapor, you get these pastel colors. And this is a development of the LED billboards, where they are now broadcasting into space, maybe even brighter than the beacon of humanity back in Nevada. But they are broadcasting into space all of these pastel colors now, because we are adorning our cities at night with that. Now, one other thing that you can do with these pictures, they're about a half hour exposure. And they're made by taking and overlaying a whole series of 30-second exposures, because that's what works well with a digital camera. To get an exposure too much greater than 30 seconds, the thermal noise starts to rear its ugly head, and you do better by keeping all your exposures less than 30 seconds. So now I had this huge stack of 30-second exposures, and I could put them together in a cumulative sum and make a movie out of it. So let's look at the movie. So here we are. Look at that. So this is a cumulative stacking of these time exposures. And so there's a thunderstorm coming in. Look at that. And you can see the stars moving, tracing out their lines. I think that's the East Coast. I'll have to check that out. And then you can see the stars going around the complement angle of 51.6. So This is my last slide. You guys and gals have been really kind sitting here for this length of time. I really like the idea of a frontier. It's a place where your normal intuition doesn't necessarily apply. And you can go there and learn new things. The answers won't be in the back of the book. You're going to have to figure stuff out for yourself. But it's these details that make human beings want to explore frontiers. And at first, the information learned will tickle your mind and enrich your imagination, but eventually it'll trickle down into practical things that help build a better society. And when you go into these frontiers, particularly for scientific-based expeditions, you have a set of programmatic goals and programmatic experiments that are well thought, well designed, peer reviewed, and you do those as a crew member when you go to the International Space Station. But because you are in this amazing environment, it's bizarre, it's different, and you are there in this wonderful laboratory with all this stuff around you, and you don't necessarily shut your brain down at the end of the day when you get done with your evening conference with Mission Control. You can still think about these things, and you can think about things in a way that's different than an engineer or PI on the ground trying to design an experiment that's never been in space before. And so you can use this as opportunistic science and come up with new things. Little vignettes which at the very least are educational demonstrations, but maybe you can bring them to some kind of scientific endpoint. And we do this all the time in laboratories on the ground. It's the standard practice. And the clandestine science that we do in our labs on the ground oftentimes gives us the seeds to write another proposal. And you got a little bit of data, and maybe it's not high quality data, but you got enough data to show something's good, and then you can get funded, and that now becomes a programmatic experiment. So with that, let me stop and give everybody a chance to hit the bar again, or ask questions, or whatever you'd like. Yeah, I'm willing to answer questions. Any questions?
So this might sound a little strange, but you said you found all your co-authors randomly. Where do you hang out where you find all these people?
What happens, like Boris Herzen, I was at actually a destination station meeting. I think it was in Denver, and I gave one of my kind of hand-waving talks like that, and I showed the video of all these blobs going out, and I didn't really know enough to know that there's anything of scientific interest, and I just thought it was cool. And Boris came up afterwards and said, "Those are Taylor cones. Can I get the video? I think there's good information in it." So a lot of my colleagues end up finding me because they hear me talk and do things, and I'm waiting for somebody to come up after a presentation and say, "I'm a yo-yo physicist and I want to analyze your yo-yo." I haven't yet been able to get any peer-reviewed publication out from my yo-yos.
No physicists who love yo-yos, so I should probably...
Oh, yes, please, because I've got a lot of yo-yo video that's buried in the NASA archives. Any other questions?
Hey, Don, do you think that there are lots of people on the ground who would just come up with ideas, things that you could look at on station, just ad hoc, using what you've got there?
Yeah, actually, good point, Shep. And if so...
How do we make that work without all this bureaucracy to say, you know, what astronauts can do on orbit?
I have people approach me all the time with ideas, and generally speaking, they're all under 22. You know, they're basically college-age kids. They've had enough education so that they understand things about math and physics and chemistry and things like that. So they know enough to be dangerous. And they come up with all these ideas when they see this. And I try to parse as many of them as I can and pass them on. NASA has a really cool program now. It's called Hunch. And we have cadres of high school students scattered throughout the United States, and they are making space flight hardware that flies to station. And it's typically stuff that NASA engineers won't touch or haven't thought about. And a lot of it involves pleasantries for the crew, like a new galley table, a really cool ball and clamp socket arrangements that you can clamp things down to handrails, and they've come up with a bunch of really neat things that we fly up to station. It's called the Hunch Program. We actually have some full-time people at NASA that help shepherd the students from an idea point of view in and work it in through NASA safety and engineering, and they actually build it, and they're making soft goods. We have people in high school sewing labs sewing up soft goods that fly to station. It's really, really neat. It's really neat to see at least this one venue for getting the ideas all the way through hardware flown up to station. Any other questions? Yes. Oh, you know, I need to think about that a little bit. What would I do on the surface of Mars? Let me think about that a bit. Now, let me ask you one thing. I've got another video that's a 3-minute video. It's kind of cool. Would you mind if I show one more little video? Okay. And this, again, is another sort of a science of opportunity thing, or goofing around in space. And it has to do with a speaker cone that happened to fall out from one of our little external speaker boxes that we had on station. And then I could drive it with our MP3 player that I happened to have that I had a little signal generator, a signal generator app on it, so I could drive different tones and square waves and triangle waves and things. And then you can put water on the speaker cone and look at the oscillation. So
we have, let me get a big giggle at that. That water sphere now is about 62 millimeters in diameter. And just gauging, it looks like that air bubble is about 40. And the air bubble is attached to the speaker cone, and so is the water. And I'm at 60 hertz. I'm going to start increasing the amplitude. Here we go. Wow. So we're getting a series of standing nodes on the interface of the air bubble with the water. I'm going to put a square wave in. Okay. Triangle wave. Wow. Let me go to 150. With a black background. I'm gonna keep the black background for a while. Let's do it over. Thank you.
Thank you.